breathe back there.
God is so good to me. God is so good to me. He saved me, forgave me, set my soul free, filled me with victory. God is so good to me. He's always so good to me. So loving and caring and faithful is He. God is so good to me, to me. God is so good to me. God is so good to me. God is so good to me. He saved me, forgave me, set my soul free, filled me with victory. God is so good to me. He's always so good to me. So loving and caring and faithful is He. God is so good to me, to me. God is so good to me. God is so good to me. God is so good to me. He saved me, forgave me, set my soul free. Of Jesus, victory in the name of Jesus. No other name I know. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name.
I want you to welcome to my pulpit tonight Paul and Melissa Woosley and their family. Would you give them a warm welcome tonight in the house of the Lord? Amen.
Hallelujah. How many of you can say that our God is greater? That we serve a great and a mighty God tonight? Oh, come on, stand with me. Don't sit down now. We're just going to worship the Lord. We're going to bless His name, and we're going to exalt Him and lift Him up. So come on, church. Let's put our hands together, and let's just lift up the name of the Lord Jesus Christ tonight. Hallelujah.
The water you turn into wine. You open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like You. Darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. No one like You. None like You. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, You are higher than any other. Our God is healer. He's awesome in power.
Your voice and sing, because
our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, You are higher than any.
Oh,
other.
Yes, You are God.
Our God is healer, He's awesome in power. Our God,
He's our God.
God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, He's awesome.
And it's Your breath
Say he is great and greatly to be praised. Let's all sing, how great is our God. Sing with me. that you are great.
Oh, we'll sing
how great, how great is our God. Father, we bless your holy name tonight, God. We thank you, Lord, for allowing us this opportunity, Lord. God, this privilege to be in your house among your people in your presence. And Heavenly Father, I pray tonight, God, that your will shall be done in this place. God, that you will, Lord, change our minds, Lord. Change our thought patterns, Father God. Lord, creating us a clean heart, renewing us a right spirit, Father God. Help us today to enter into the Holy of Holies, God. Lord, that we will leave here not the same way we came, but we'll leave here, Lord, tonight revived and refreshed and renewed and ready. Lord, ready to face the challenges of the world, Father. God, truly you are great and you are greatly to be praised, Lord. And God, tonight I just pray, God, that you will allow heaven and earth to collide in this place. I pray tonight, God, that you will, Lord, have your way, Lord God, that heaven, Lord, shall come and reside in this place, Lord, and that your will, Lord, will be done, Lord, in all things, Father God, in all things. Oh, acapella, how great is our God. God has been great to you. I want you to put your hands together, amen, and give him a clap. Come on, give him a praise. Amen. Give him praise, amen, for who he is. For the Bible says in him, amen, we live and breathe and have our very being, amen. It's because of Jesus that you woke up this morning, amen. Hallelujah, amen. I'm so glad to see you. You may be seated if you can. It's so good to be in the house of the Lord, amen. So good to be here at Faith Temple. So good to be with your pastor. It's so good to see family, friends. You know, man, wow, Mike, we're getting old. Wow, my goodness, it's good to see you guys, and I'm just excited. Hasn't God been good? Amen. Sunday morning, Sunday night, yesterday, God has truly just showed up and showed off. Amen. Showed up and showed off. That's all you can say about it. Amen. Well, Pastor has asked me tonight if I would receive the offering, and it's my privilege, you know, to receive the offering, but I want you to know what your offering goes toward. Now, as many of you know, I pastor in Ocala, Florida. It's about 2.5 hours north. It's called the horse capital of the world. Now, I'm originally from Lexington, Kentucky, which is called the horse capital of the world. I don't know who's right. I don't really care who's right. All I know is that I get to see horses and, you know, and dream of the glory days. All right. When I played football in high school. I played football middle school. I played football in Pop Warner, and I never had a broken bone. But when I got on a horse, every broken bone in my body came from a horse. Oh, my goodness. Amen. But it's good to sit back and watch, you know, and I instead of chasing the rabbit trails, let me get back on to what I was going to say. Is that what we do is God has just inspired us that we go about 6 weeks out of the year, and we go and we preach the gospel, amen. But we don't go to just any church. We go to where God leads us. You know, there's been many that we've turned down. We just turned down someone here recently. We just said we just didn't feel like God was opening that door for us to come. But maybe, you know, we'll come again next year. But what I'm the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. I am the North Florida area director. And I go into schools and I preach God's Word. I go into colleges and I preach God's Word. And I give out these Bibles. I give out these Bibles. Now, my church does not pay for these Bibles. I pay for these Bibles out of what I do when we have these evangelistical services and what you give. So last year alone, we saw 83 young athletes come to Christ. 83 people gave their hearts to the Lord. Amen. Now, that doesn't count the church. That's just athletes. That were people that came to these huddles and came to these events that we had, and it's just been amazing journey for me. And and we give out these Bibles. I have about 10 of these left, and tonight I'm just going to challenge you. If you don't have a Bible, I'm going to give you one. All right, I've got about 10 of these left, and I give these out all the time. I know your pastor does as well, but these are athletic Bibles. They have testimonies of athletes, whether it's soccer or baseball. We just had an FCA banquet where I had for the baseball team at Central Florida College, and I had some national leaguers come in, and I had their fathers come in, and had just different ones come in and speak, and just had a great time. We had two or three of the baseball team that had never known about the gospel. They never knew. You know, I can imagine no one knowing who Jesus Christ is. Not. You know, I can't imagine. I grew up in church. I've known about God. I've known the stories, amen, all of my life. I mean, I speak to people. They don't know who King David is. They don't know who Samson was. They don't know who Moses was. Amen. But that's the kind of people I want to get. Amen. And we can get that through as we give out these Bibles to them. But we cannot do that without your help. We're going, whether we have to pull from our own pockets, and we continue to do this. We continue to go for the Lord. Amen. And 83 souls, you are sowing into kingdom ministry. Amen. When you sow into, amen, young people. Amen. Jesus said you got to be like one of those to get up there. Amen. And we know that Moses said, blessed is he that gives. Amen. Blessed is he that gives to others. Amen. And we know that in the New Testament it says it's always better to give than to receive. Amen. And so we thank you. We thank you for feeding us. We thank you for all the hospitality that you've shown this week. Amen. Someone even took us out for ice cream today. Thank you so much for that ice cream. It was wonderful. The kids loved it. I loved it. And it made me sweeter. At least Sister Melissa, she hasn't told me that I was sweeter today, but I know it made me sweeter. It had to. It was delicious. But we thank you for your offerings. We thank you just for your support, okay? Now, your tithe stays in the house. All right, your tithe stays in the house of God, but we thank you for your offerings tonight. Amen. So as the ushers prepare to receive our offering tonight, amen, the kids, we've asked them to sing a song for us, and then we're going to go straight into the Word, okay? So if you are making checks out, make them to FTM. Very simple. FTM. All right, so if you're making checks out, make them to FTM, and Pastor will make sure that we get to that. Amen, and we thank you for your generosity. So now let me pray over your gift. Father, I pray, God, that you will touch, Lord, every gift that is given. Lord, you simply said little is much when you are in it. And so, Father God, I am praying now, Lord, not God, that for equal gift but equal sacrifice. Lord, there might be people in here tonight that cannot give what others give. But God, I pray, God, that we will, Lord, present, Lord, a sacrifice, Lord. You said to present our bodies as living sacrifices, Lord. So tonight, God, for this sacrifice, the seed of faith, Father, I thank you for the seed of faith, Lord. And I pray, God, that you will multiply it. I pray that you will expand it, Lord. I pray, God, that you will use it, Lord, to reach, Lord, the lost. Father God, I thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we have to give in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people say, amen, amen. Ushers, you may receive. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give it up for them one more time. Amen. 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 They do such a wonderful job. I am so blessed. Amen. I am a blessed father, and I just realized that I messed up. I messed up. You know how I messed up? I didn't give you my outline. Joshua, here, run this back there. They told me make sure I give them an outline every night, and I've already messed up. All right? So I guess I'm fired. Amen. But it is good to see you. So if you have your words, turn with me to Mark, the gospel according to Mark, Mark chapter 5. Amen. We're so thankful to be in God's house tonight. We're so thankful that he spoke to us this morning as we left last night. What a wonderful time in the Lord we had at the altar last night. Amen. What a wonderful time we had in the altar last night. Amen. Of people rededicating their lives, of souls, you know, being saved, of bodies being healed, of the prodigal children coming home. Amen. Of just everything taking place. Amen. I don't know what you believe. Amen. But I believe the report of the Lord. You see, I thank God for good nurses. And I thank God for good doctors. But I thank God for the great physician. Amen, that we have in Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the only one that can heal and feel. He's the only one, amen, that can bless you, amen, that no one else can bless. Amen. He is the only person, amen, that can fill the void in your life that a bottle, a pill, or anything else cannot. Amen. It's all about Jesus. Look at your neighbor and say, it's all about Jesus. And tonight, I am convinced of this. Now, as I was talking to someone at the hotel today, I'm convinced of this tonight. I'm convinced that we all, somebody say all. I am convinced that we all have struggles. All right? If I was to say who doesn't have a struggle, you know, raise your hand. You know, don't do it. But you know we all have struggles. We all go through baggage, you know, the baggage claim area every now and then. All right? We all have those closets that we hide things and hide issues that we deal with. And I believe tonight, whether you're watching live stream or Facebook, that everyone under the sound of my voice, you have a current current issue that you are facing. Whether it is something troubling your mind, something you are worrying about, something you are fretting over. It could be an illness. It could be a financial problem. It could be temptation. But whatever it might be, amen, we all, somebody say all, we all have issues, and tonight they need to be dealt with. That's why I'm here. Amen. God has sent me on this pre-appointed destination, amen, to deal with these issues. And just like this woman in this passage of scripture we are getting ready to read, she had issues that nobody, somebody say nobody, nobody could solve her issues. So she did what any God-fearing person would do. She took it to Jesus. Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm taking it to Jesus. I'm taking it to Jesus. Amen. So Mark chapter 5, verse 25. It's a very familiar piece of scripture. Amen. But God has given me some spiritual nuggets to share with you here at FTM. All right. And verse 25, the Bible says, a certain woman which had an issue of blood for 12 years and had suffered many things. Somebody say many things. And many physicians. Somebody say many physicians. And she had spent all, somebody say all, she had spent all that she had and was nothing better, but she rather grew worse. Now, verse 27, when she had heard of Jesus, she came in the press behind and she touched his garment, for she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway, the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus immediately, somebody say immediately, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out. Now, how would he know that virtue left? Think about this. Immediately he knew that virtue had gone out of his body. Now, let me give you just a little insight of altar service. Amen. God anoints your pastor. God anoints pastors all across this great country that we live in this great world that we are part of. He anoints teachers, preachers. He anoints you, amen, as the chosen. You are the elect of God. You're a chosen generation, are you not? All right. Are you a temple of the Holy Spirit? All right, so he anoints you. And as you pray for someone, amen, here's an example of that virtue. As you pray for someone, amen, that anointing begins to flow out of you. In John chapter 7, did it not say, out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water? Amen. Come on now. You truly do not know what somebody has inside of them until they are squeezed. Now, that's just good preaching. That wasn't part of the notes at all. That was free of charge. All right? Amen. When you get under pressure, we've been driving up and down this road right here, and Eden, even though she was born in Florida, she doesn't remember she was born at Cape Canaveral, and she doesn't remember that in our backyard we had tangelos, and we had grapefruit, and we had orange trees. She doesn't remember all that. And we've been driving up and down this road, and she sees all these orange groves. She said, Daddy, I want to stop and pick an orange. I said, you can't. It's called trespassing. Can't do it. You know, can't do it. But you never know what someone has inside of them until they are squeezed. So she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, then I'll be made whole. And she did. And Jesus immediately felt virtue leave his body. And he turned about into the people. And he said, who touched my clothes? Now, if you know anything there is to know about the Bible, wherever Jesus went, there was a multitude. Okay? That's why there were several times in the scripture that Jesus had to get away. When he sent the disciples on the other side of the sea, and he got away to the mountain, you know, to pray. He had to get away. Sometimes the most spiritual thing you can do is just get yourself away from everybody. That's just good preaching, Pastor Woosley. That's good preaching, Bishop Woosley. Sometimes the most spiritual thing you need to do is just rest. All right? Just rest. All right? Because everywhere Jesus went, multitudes were there, and they were pressing him. And the disciples recognized that, because here in verse 31, the disciples said unto him, "Do you not see the multitude thronging you and saying to you, to us, who touched me?" Now, they were being sarcastic. They really were. They were being sarcastic. And that Jesus, he didn't worry about that. He looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done inside of her, she came and she fell down before him, and she told him all of the truth. And he said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith had made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." Let's pray over the reading of God's word. Father, we thank you, God, for your word. We thank you, God, Lord, for every man, every child, every woman in this place, Lord. And God, tonight I pray that you give us an ear to hear and a heart to receive what the Spirit has to say, in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people say today, amen. Now, I believe the only way we will see results in our lives tonight is if we will take our issues to the master of the universe. No, I'm not talking about He-Man. Amen. I'm talking about the man. I'm talking about the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. I'm talking about Jesus Christ. He is the only one that can solve your current issues tonight. He is the only one that will turn your mourning into dancing and your sorrows into joy. He's the only one that can turn your situation around. The Bible says, though the enemy may come in like a flood, God will raise up a standard against him, and that standard is Jesus. Amen. And if we would just put our issues into the hands of Jesus and allow Jesus to work it out, he will bring you victory. Hallelujah. You see, I'm just an old country boy. I like that song, "Me and Jesus Got Our Own Thing Going." You know, me and Jesus got it all worked out. Amen. And that's what I'm trying to tell you today. It's all about Jesus. He will restore what's been broken. He will do what man and woman cannot do. If you will press in and get a hold of Jesus tonight, you will not leave here the same person you came in. Amen. So as we look at this story, the Lord has given me five spiritual nuggets that I want to give you. Actually, they're actually questions that I want you to question yourself. Amen. The first one is, do your issues know who you are? Let me say that again. That's worth repeating. Do your issues know who you are? Now, I have read this Bible many times. Have you ever noticed that this woman's name was never mentioned? I mean, what was her name? What was her name? Was it Betty? Was it Sue? Was it Melissa? Was it Eden? You know, what was her name? What was her name? What was her name? It never tells us her name. All we know about her is that she was the woman with the issue. She was the woman with the issue. She was the woman with the problem. She was known by her infirmity. That's all the information that they needed to describe her. Everyone knew her as the woman with the issue. Even the writer wrote about her as the woman with the issue. In other words, this woman was defined by her issue. Everyone and everyone and everywhere Wherever she went, she was known by the woman of the issue. She wasn't known by her name. She was totally defined by her issue. It's like the man that was at the gate called Beautiful. No one knew his name. All they knew him as he was lame from his mother's womb. That's all they knew about him. Amen. But when Peter and John showed up and he begged for alms, they said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have I give thee. In the name of Jesus, rise up and walk." And the Bible says he rose up and he went walking and leaping and praising God. That's what Jesus does in your life, amen. But what do you know? You know, does your issue know who you are? And as I was preparing this message last night and this morning, that question just stuck in me and rose in me. And I mean, how many of us are known and defined by our issue? Oh, that's the bitter woman, you know. She's never been the same since that devastation. She's never been the same since that distraction. She's never been the same since that detour. She's never been the same since he cheated on her or this or that or whatever. Or that's that bitter man. That's that man that can't control his anger. He's temporal. Don't get around him. Or that's the couple that's divorced. You don't want to be around him. That's the girl who did this, or that's the boy who did that. That's the person who's always depressed. That's the person who's always is negative and pessimistic. You know, I told you the hee-haw theory, right? You know, that's the person who gloom, despair, and agony on me. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be around those people. I don't want no part of that. Amen. I want to be around somebody that is positive and sees Jesus. Amen. Why? Because iron sharpens iron. Amen. But how many of us know people like that? I mean, think about our lives. We become defined so many times and not even know it by our issues. We walk around sometimes with a name tag pasted on us, amen, and tells us what our issue is. Come on, it's just like Naomi in the book of Ruth, chapter 1. Naomi, she lost it all, and she said, "Call me Mara, because God has dealt bitterly with me." She changed her own name because of her issue. We become so totally wrapped up in what's happening inside to us instead of what's happening in us. And because of that, these issues, they define our attitudes and our actions, the way we talk and the way we walk, the way we behave and the way, what we believe. We allow, amen, these issues to define us, amen, instead of accepting who we are in Christ Jesus, amen. Listen, how many... Let me give you some good advice tonight. Amen. Don't you look at the world. Don't you worry about what your neighbor says about you. Don't you worry about what anybody says about you. You worry about what God says. Because God says you are justified by faith. Amen. And you have peace with him. Amen. It is not in this economy. It is not in men and women that I trust. It's not in this government. It's not in this community. My trust is in him. My peace is in him. He is the Prince of Peace and the Lord of Lords. The Bible tells me in Romans 8:1 that I am free from condemnation. In chapter 8 verse 16, I'm a child of God. In Romans 8:17, I'm an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. In 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9, I'm a chosen generation. I'm a royal priesthood. I'm a holy nation. I'm a peculiar people, and I'm supposed to show forth the praise to the one who called me out of darkness into his marvelous light. My God, in the words of my father and all that ought to make a mummy shout. Hallelujah. Amen. Don't let people tell you that you're this or you that. Look what the Word says about you. Ephesians chapter 2 verse 10. I am a workmanship of God, created for good works, not bad works. Revelations 12. I'm an overcomer by the blood of the Lamb and the word of my testimony. Amen. We are more than conquerors through the blood of Jesus Christ. So let's be defined by who we are in Christ instead of what others say. Amen. What our issue might make us out to be. Somebody say with me, I'm a child of the King. Now put your hands together and give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Amen. So don't be disqualified. You know, I don't like being disqualified. As a coach, I've been disqualified a time or two. I got kicked out of the game one time for stomping my feet. I was so mad. I was the head basketball coach, and you know, basketball is a gentleman's sport, you know, and I dress up, and this coach, this official, he blew it. I mean, he really blew it, and I just, are you kidding me? Are you blind? He threw me out. Amen. So don't be disqualified. Number two, amen, are you disqualified? Are you disqualified? You see, because of her issue, the Bible tells us she could not even go worship like we are here tonight. Because of her issue, she was not allowed to enter into the temple. Because of her issue, she could not even have a relationship with her family. She could not even be intimate with her husband. She wasn't allowed. Leviticus chapter 15 verse 25 declares that everything and everyone she touched would be unclean. She even had to stand afar off and she had to shout, I'm unclean, don't come any further. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine the humility, the shame? She was cut off from God and man. She was cut off from life. She was disqualified by her issue. Doesn't that sound like a lot of us? Come on now, be honest. Amen. That sounds like a lot of us. Because of our issues, the way we feel disqualified from everything and everyone. Pastor, I can't worship because of what's happened in my life. Pastor, you just don't understand. I can't worship because of all these things that have happened to me today. I got in the biggest fight with my wife a Sunday morning coming to church. So there's no way I can lift my hands. Well, baby, fake it till you make it. You know how many fights on Sunday mornings? Listen, the enemy is on overdrive on Sunday mornings. He is on overdrive. Overdrive. He's been working on us. We just had a flat tire today. You know? And I just put brand new tires on it. And the lady at the front desk, she knew what button to push. She said, let me give you a little advice. I said, all right, I love advice. She said, don't drive near construction sites. I looked at her. I'm a preacher. Right now, I'm an evangelist. I ain't doing no construction. I couldn't put the two and two together. You know, okay, we'll just go. But, Pastor, I can't worship because of what's happened in my life. I can't serve on any committee of the church because I'm so busy. I can't help you with that outreach of that food ministry you have because I'm sick. I can't help with the youth because I don't feel qualified. Well, hear me today, amen. Amen. It's God who qualifies you. Oh, here, I told you this, amen, that we live in a generation now, thank God for education, amen, and I'm furthering my education, and I want my children to go and further their education, but we cannot forget about revelation. Amen, don't get so educated that you think you know it all. Come on now, Isaiah 40 tells us there is no understanding, amen, of God. amen, that you will not know those some things you just don't know. Amen. Pastor, you know, I can't this or I can't that. I can't impact anyone. I can't do anything for God because of my issue. Well, I was raised up on a farm, and my daddy said you can't, never could do anything. And I'm here to tell you, yes, you can. Yes, you can. You can. God wants you to achieve your dreams and your visions of life, your destiny. But you've got to be willing to press in. Amen. Come on, church. Are you here tonight? Sometimes you got to roll your sleeves up and get a little dirty and press in. Sometimes you got to just get a little rude about it and press on and press through, because if God led you to it, he'll take you through it. Amen. My God, my God, my God. So many times we blame so many things. You know, Pastor, I can't this because of my sickness, because of my infirmities, you know. I understand that many people are broke, busted, and disgusted. I understand that your money's funny and your change is strange. But hear me today, God. Oh, hear me today. My Father, hallelujah. He owns many, many, many hills and many, many cattle. And he owns the gold in those hills. And he shall supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. Hallelujah. Amen. So many people want to say this and that. I can't. But you can. You can. Amen. We just had a lady in our church, 99 years old. Amen. 99. Sister Ethel, 99, correct? 99. Still being used of God. Amen. 99 years old. You know, and some of these young bucks want to tell me they can't. Amen. 99. She was still calling me, Pastor, what can I do for the church? 99 years old, she was calling me. I've got to do something for the church, Pastor. Give me something to do. I need to do something. My God, my God. I think about Melissa's grandfather at 96 years old. They put him in a Catholic nursing home. You know, a Catholic nursing home. And they caught him sneaking out. They said, Brother Morgan, where are you going? He said, well, I looked in the phone book and I didn't see any Pentecostal churches in this area, so I'm going to go start one. Don't tell me you're disqualified. God says you are qualified. He takes the unqualified and he qualifies you and tells you that you are redeemed, you are restored, you are renewed, you are refreshed, and this week you are revived. My God, my God, my God. The late, great John Nicholas. We was just talking about John Nicholas today. Amen. That was over Operation Compassion, one of our general overseers. I was talking to him out in New Mexico one time. I was out there. Big old tall guy. He said, Paul, he said, sometimes you just got to get a little rude about your blessing. So he said, sometimes you just got to press in, press on, and press through. Somebody say, I'm pressing in. Somebody say, I'm pressing on. Somebody say, I'm pressing through. And tonight I'm telling you, if you will press in, amen, to these altars, you will receive from the Lord. Somebody give God praise. Amen. Number three, amen. My third question is, thirdly, does your issue give you drive? Amen. You know, are you competitive? Now, I'm a competitor. I'm a competitor. I really am. I hate to lose. I'm a sore loser. We started the church softball team several years ago. And they had the audacity. They wanted me to be the pitcher. Now, I'm a pretty good pitcher. But what happens in church softball leagues is you take the big boys that play the travel leagues, and they'll come into these church leagues, and that's basically practice for them. I don't know if that happens here in Hardy County or not. But in Marion County, that's all that happens. I mean, you know, now we had a 3-home-run rule, okay? But the rule also stated that you had to be a member and attend the church you're playing with. And these big old boys, they'd be out in the parking lot. They'd come up, "Pastor, you need somebody to help?" I said, "Nope, nope, I don't need nobody." I mean, sometimes I played with seven, sometimes I played with eight. Sometimes I just played. You know, we played. Sometimes we had even kids, you know, playing because I was not going to break the rules. We're going to do it. But I was a pitcher, and I'm a competitor, and I hate to lose. That's why I'm a Christian. I read the back of the book. We win. Yeah. We win. We win. And there was this big old boy. He got on this other team, and I'm not going to say what kind of church it was, but anyways, he got on this other team, and every time he got on that team would let him get on. And he didn't go to a church a day in his life. I prayed for him, but he cusses and fusses, and he does all kinds of things. I mean, Lord God, help him save his soul. But he was a slugger, man. I mean, I could pitch left, right. I could give him a knuckleball, screwball, whatever kind of ball you want to think. And I would pitch it 6 feet out. He'd step over and still hit. And then you'd hear thump, do, 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 do. Because everybody parked out there, you know. I was like, that's crazy. Why would you want to park out in the outfield, you know? I always park back behind the dugout. So he got up there one time, and he got up there, and as he got up there, I looked at my pitcher, timeout, come here, or my catcher. I said, let's just walk this guy. I said, if I go like this, you run the opposite side. I'm tired of this guy hitting homers on us. I don't want to give him no homers, none. And man, I did that, and it made him mad. Oh, then he started trash talking me, like the Goliath trash talking David. He said, "You're a chicken." And I'm the pastor of the church. I got my church name on my jersey. I got a number. I got everything. Nobody calls me chicken. You're a coward. You don't want to pitch to me. I couldn't take it. Sister Cindy, that third time he said that, man, I threw my glove down. All I had in my hand was a softball. You know that's really going to hurt him. That ain't going to. He's got a metal bat that was probably loaded. Man, I ran up to him, and I'm looking at him, and I said, let me tell you something right now. And as I'm running, I saw my little pretty wife. She was sitting back there in the dugout, behind the dugout. She's running, going like slow motion. Don't do it! I run up to him, and I said, I'm not scared of man. I'm not scared of beast. I'm only scared of one woman, and she's standing right there, and she's praying that I don't hit you right now, right in your big fat nose. I told him that, and he just threw away. He couldn't take it. He couldn't take it. Take your base. Amen. Amen. Don't let the things of life disqualify you. Amen. I mean, think about, you know, this woman, as far as, you know, being a competitor, if you're a competitor here tonight, I mean, this was driving her. I mean, it could have been driving her crazy. You know, dealing with it for 12 long years, I couldn't imagine dealing with the sickness for 12 long years. Amen. I mean, I had one this month, this summer, where, but Mike, I don't know, I spent 20 days in the hospital this summer. You know, I went in at 210 pounds, came out 170 pounds. You know, that's not the way you lose weight. I don't recommend it to nobody. Amen. But I just couldn't imagine dealing with this for 12 long years. That's 4,380 days of her life, she woke up knowing she had an issue. I mean, can you imagine that? It had to be the last thing she thought of when she put her head to rest. It had to be the first thing she thought of when she woke up in the morning. While other people were relaxing and laughing and joking and playing games, she had an issue. While other women were rocking their babies and kissing their grandchildren, she had an issue. While other people talked about the weather and when they're going to go shopping at the mall, she had an issue. While other people were dancing and shouting and glorifying God, she still had an issue. Amen. And the Lord showed me that many of our churches are so consumed, amen, with these issues that we miss the opportunity to be made whole. We miss the opportunity of blessing. We miss the opportunity of healing. We miss the opportunity, amen, of fulfilling our destiny. Amen. We miss that opportunity. So the message tonight is don't quit. Don't give up. Don't give out. Don't give in to the temptations of the enemy. Amen. Don't allow your issue to disqualify you. It might be on your mind, amen, every day. Amen. It might invade your thought process. But I know this, amen. If we will stick to what God says, He will free you from these things. Because He says in Ephesians chapter 6, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand the evil day. And having done everything, after you've done it all, after you went to the bank, after you went to the doctor, after you spent it all, you stand on the word of God. You stand on His word, amen. Watch and see what He will do. Stand therefore, the Bible says, having your loins girt about with truth. Many of you here tonight, you're driven by your issue, amen. And the Lord wants to bring release. Hallelujah. The word declares that this woman's issue cost her everything. So my fourth question, I'm going to try to hurry right along. How many give me 5 more minutes? How many will give me? 5, 10, 15, 20, 30. Okay, we got all kinds of time. All right. But I'm going to hurry it up real quick. Are you devastated by your issue? You see, I couldn't imagine having this issue. But imagine her devastation. You know, devastation is damage, destruction, detouring from the blessings of God. See, the word says she spent everything she had and still only grew worse. She was devastated. She tried everything. Amen. Because the Bible says she tried many things. Now, if you look into history, there are 11 cures for her issue during that time. They were all type of tonics and superstitions, from the carrying of ashes of an ostrich egg in a cotton bag and all kinds of things. And I believe this woman tried it all and it only grew worse. She was devastated. It cost her all of her energy, all of her money, and all of her dignity. Everywhere she went, she had to shout out because she was embarrassed about it. She came to town, she had to scream that she was disqualified. I mean, why else would she sneak up behind Jesus? She was embarrassed about it. She was embarrassed about having to disclose her issue. Her life had been devastated. It cost her everything. And as a minister of the gospel, I go everywhere. We just got back from Virginia. We were in West Virginia. We were up in the Carolinas preaching. You know, our church is so gracious to let us go and preach the word of God. Amen. But I find people all across the country that are devastated by issue. They're embarrassed by their issues, but they won't do anything about their issues. They just go through the same old, same old. Aren't you sick and tired of being sick and tired? The answer is Jesus. The answer is Jesus. We have the answer in Jesus. Amen. We have the answer. Amen. If God be for us, who can be against us? Amen. Who can lay charge to God's elect? Amen. So I ask you, amen, as I close and the family comes, amen, are you desperate enough to change your issue? You see, we talked about desperation, did we not? We talked about preparation for revival, of being desperate for a move of God. being desperate for God to move in this city of Wauchula, for God to move in this county of Hardy County and move upon Polk and all the other counties are surrounding. You know, are you desperate enough? See, the final thing we notice about this woman and her issue is that it drove her to a point of desperation. She came to the conclusion that she was so desperate, she would do whatever it takes. Whatever means necessary to resolve the issue. But she had to push past the shame. She had to go past the embarrassment. You know, sometimes we don't want people knowing our business. But God says you have not because you ask not. She pushed past those things. She went past man's protocol. She passed the belief, amen, that nothing will ever change. She was so desperate for change, amen, that God showed up and showed off. Times, listen to me, times that we are living in. You live in the same country I live in, and thank God that we, finally did something right. And, you know, and you might like the man, but the platform, at least we're not killing babies anymore. Amen. I'm here to tell you, listen to me tonight. Amen. She had to press past everything, amen, to get to where God was. And I'm here to tell you that times are desperate, but it seems like the church is not. I'm in church all the time. I preach to anybody and everybody. Amen. And I find people that are desperate and won't do nothing about their desperation. I challenge you tonight. Listen, her desperation drove her to a place of deliverance. Her desperation drove her to divine healing. Her desperation drove her to a place of restoration. And I beg you tonight to look your life over, to examine yourself, as Paul says. Let everyone examine themselves and work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Amen. But examine yourself and think about your issues. Aren't you tired of the issue? Aren't you tired of being defined by it? Doesn't the thought of being disqualified, being driven by your issue, bring an uneasiness to your life? And I challenge you today to become so desperate that you will come, amen, and give it to God. Come and say, Lord, it's yours. I can't deal with it. I can't handle it. I can't have it. You see, I'm a prideful guy. And going through sickness, when I went through sickness, I mean, literally, laying on my back, stitches from here to here, I said, Lord, God, I need you. I can't handle it. I can't handle it. I can't do anything. Can't do nothing. Is that what it's going to take for some of us to draw closer to God? You see, God will not be mocked. God will be first in your life one way or the other. One way or the other, He's going to be first in your life. The Bible says every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess. So I challenge you tonight to be desperate enough, amen, that you'll come to these altars. Amen. Come to these altars. Amen. And touch Him. Amen. Touch Him. You don't have to touch me. Touch Him. And He will take you to that place of destiny. He will take you to that place of deliverance. He will take you to that place of direction. Are you willing to do whatever it takes? Are you desperate? desperate enough, amen, to see your family saved? Are you desperate enough to see your life changed? Holy desperation is the door to God's great blessings. And if you want to be blessed, amen, if you want relief from your issue, amen, then I want you to stand to your feet. Will you stand tonight? Father, we thank you for the reading of your word. We thank you, God, for the ministering of your word. We pray now, God, Lord, that you will, Lord, cause this word, Lord, to sink way down deep in our hearts, Father God. Lord, help us, God, to draw nigh to you, Lord. For you said if we draw nigh to you, you will draw nigh to us, Lord. God, my prayer is that we will decrease and you will increase. And Father, I pray, God, tonight, Lord, that you will, Lord, minister at these altars, Lord. God, that they will not have to come, Lord. Oh, but God, that people will begin to just fill this house, Lord, with a holy desperation for a greater move of God. Revival in Wauchula. Revival in Avon Park. Revival in Sebring. Revival, Lord, in these counties, Father God. I pray that you will move, Lord, upon our state. I pray you will move upon our nation. I pray you will move upon this planet that we call Earth, Father God, that you will help us to love one another, Lord, to treat everyone like we want to be treated, Father God. And I pray tonight for your healing virtues, Lord, to flow, Lord. God, as you have anointed me, God, Lord, that if any be sick in this place, Lord, that they will come forward, God, and they will be healed of their infirmity, God. That if there's a mother or a father that has a wayward child, Lord, that they will come forward and stand in the gap, Lord, and that child shall come home in the name of Jesus, Lord. Father God, if there's someone here, Lord, God, that is in need, that is in desperate need of a financial blessing, Lord, that they will come forward, Lord, and you will open doors that no man can shut, God, and you will close doors, Lord, that no man can open. Father, I pray tonight, God, for this congregation, Lord, God, that you will, Lord, God, cause this revival, Lord. Lord, that it will expand. It will expand. It will reach out of these walls, Lord, into the heart of this city, Father God. And I pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. If this message has touched your life, amen, you need special prayer, I want you to come. Amen. If you want to worship the Lord as they sing, I want you to come. Amen. I want you to step out. Amen. Take that initial step. Come and worship the Lord. It's still early. It's only 8:30. Amen. Come on. It's still, come and worship God and believe God for a miracle. Believe God that he's going to